like to think about the goodness of the Lord. He gives me everything I need and so much more. So I just want to lift my hands and say that I love him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. And I want to be faithful. I want to be faithful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to be, I want to be, I want to be. I like to think about the goodness of the Lord. He gives me everything I need and so much more. So I just want to lift my hands and say that I love him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. And I want to be faithful. I want to be faithful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I want to be faithful. I want to be grateful. I want to be, I want to be, I want to be faithful. I want to be
Molly, I seen you brought some friends with you again for another farm visit. It's a beautiful day, so why the long face? I never seen you look so gloomy.
I wish I didn't feel so gloomy, but I'm starting to doubt that this whole community garden idea is going to work out. I'm just an amateur gardener. How in the world am I going to make this garden a success when I barely have a clue what I'm doing? You've given me a lot of great tips and all, but there's so much work to do, and I'm afraid I'm just not up to the task.
That's the craziest thing I ever heard you say. First of all, just because you're new to gardening doesn't mean it's going to be a failure. Everyone has doubts sometimes, but you got to trust that God is going to bless what you planted. It will help you see the fruit at the end of your work, or vegetable, as the case may be.
Ha ha, good one. You really think so?
I know so. After all, faith might start out small, but it can grow into something huge, just like this acorn here. As a seed, it's so small, but just look at this giant oak tree that grows from it.
You've got a point there, Wyatt.
God is big enough to handle your doubts. Ask him for help. That actually reminds me of a Bible story I want to share with you today.
Were there people in the Bible with doubts like mine?
One of Jesus' own disciples doubted that he had risen from the dead. But Jesus didn't leave him in his doubt. Jesus loved him and proved that he was alive.
Sounds like it might be an encouraging story for me today. Let's hear it.
Have you ever heard something that just seems too good to be true? Maybe you heard a story that was just so amazing that you had a hard time believing that it was actually true. Well, what if I told you a few things about myself? Try to see if you have a hard time believing me or if you can believe me, okay? What if I told you that I can write in cursive? Would you believe me? What if I told you that I can shuffle a deck of cards? Would you believe me on that? What if I told you that I've traveled to Europe? Would you believe me? What if I told you that I can ride a unicycle? Would you believe me on that? What about if I told you that I can lift a car over my head? Would you believe me? So what was your thinking like as I was telling you these things, as I was making these claims? I'm gonna guess that as I was telling you the easy, ordinary things like writing my name in cursive, you probably just believed me on that, right? Because they're just regular, ordinary, and expected things. But as my claims became bigger and bigger and more extraordinary to the point of being pretty impossible, right? I'm sure you felt like, oh, wait, I don't believe that. Or maybe you felt like, oh, I need to see that. I need proof. I need her to show me that she can do that before I can believe her, right? Usually, when we have a hard time believing, we want proof and we want evidence that it's actually true before we can really be convinced that it's true, right? Well, in today's Bible story, some people had a hard time believing that Jesus rose again from the dead because it was in fact something that was so incredible and that they demanded evidence to prove that it was true. So let's turn our Bibles to John 20 and let's find out what happened.
On the first day of the week, in the evening, the disciples gathered together in a house. They locked the doors because they were afraid of the Jews. They didn't want to be killed like Jesus had been killed. Some of Jesus' disciples had reported seeing him alive. Was it true? As the disciples talked, Jesus appeared among them and said, "Peace to you." The disciples were afraid. They thought they were seeing a ghost. "It's me," Jesus said. "Look at me and touch me. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, but I do." Jesus showed his disciples his hands and his side. They saw his wounds. The disciples rejoiced because they were so happy to see Jesus. The disciples gave Jesus some fish to eat. Jesus talked to them and explained the Bible to them. "The Bible is about me," Jesus said. He helped them understand how the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms told about him. Then Jesus told the disciples that they had a job to do. Jesus had died and was raised from the dead so that people could be forgiven for their sins. The disciples needed to tell other people to repent from their sins and be forgiven. Jesus said, "God sent me to earth, and in the same way, I am sending you." One of Jesus' disciples, Thomas, was not with the others when Jesus visited him. He did not believe that Jesus was alive. Thomas said, "I want to see and touch the holes in his hands and his side, or I will never believe." A week later, Thomas was with the disciples when Jesus appeared again. Jesus said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Reach out and touch my side. Don't be an unbeliever. Believe." Thomas did believe. "My Lord and my God," he said. Jesus said, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Those who believe in me without seeing me are blessed."
Jesus' disciples claimed that Jesus had risen from the dead and that they had seen him, but Thomas had a hard time believing that it was true. He demanded to see more evidence. Thomas was one of Jesus' disciples, and he had walked with Jesus for 3 years before he was crucified. And when he heard that Jesus was alive, he had a hard time believing that it's true. He thought it was just too good to be true. It wasn't enough that Jesus predicted his resurrection before he died on the cross, or that Jesus' tomb was empty, or that so many of Jesus' friends and followers had said the same thing. Thomas still demanded more proof. No, it's not necessarily bad for us to be skeptical or doubtful. No, God doesn't want us to believe everything that anyone says just because they're saying that it's true. But the problem with Thomas's doubt is that he already had plenty of evidence already. But Jesus wasn't angry with Thomas for doubting. Instead, Jesus held out his hands so that Thomas could see the scars from where he had been nailed to the cross. And Jesus showed proof that it was indeed him who was standing alive in front of him. You know, we can't see Jesus with our eyes the way his friends did, but Jesus also makes himself known to us today. Last week, we talked about how the whole entire Bible points to Jesus. And today, as we read the Bible, we could find out and we can know who Jesus is and all that God wants us to know about him. I'm going to draw a picture right now, and I want you guys to, as I draw, I want you guys to go grab a piece of paper and a pen or a pencil or a crayon, and I want you guys to come back with those things as I take time to draw this picture. All right, do you guys have your paper and pencils? Okay, so I'm not going to show you my picture. You can't see my picture right now, but I'm going to try to explain and describe my picture to you. And I want you guys to try to draw the same picture that I have on this paper, okay? So you gotta listen carefully and try your best to imitate or to draw exactly what I drew, okay? So on the left side of my paper, I have a house. It has a triangle roof, okay? And in the middle of the house, there is a door, okay, with a little dot as the handle. And then on the right side of the house, there is a little window. Okay, and then on the right side of the paper, there is a sun that's a circle with rays coming out of it. Okay, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rays coming out of it. Okay, so were you guys able to draw this picture? Did you complete it? Did your picture look close or similar to this picture right here? The more your picture looks close to this, the better job I did of describing and the better job you did of paying attention and trying to pick up everything that I was saying, right? Well, the Bible is kind of like this. Now, there were people who saw Jesus dying on the cross, and they also saw him as he rose again from the dead. And those people that saw him, or those people that heard directly from people that saw him, wrote the Gospels describing all the things that happened to Jesus as they were walking with Jesus, right? And so when we read the Bible, you know, we need to, it's very important for us to read very carefully, okay, and for us to try to pick up everything that these writers are trying to say. Of course, this is something that God wants to tell us, and it's inspired by God, but people, eyewitnesses, we call it, people that actually saw Jesus and walked with Jesus, you know, they saw him face to face, they wrote it down, and we can be assured that there is truth in the Bible, that the Bible is true, because, of course, because God is the one that who made it, but also because eyewitnesses have recorded and documented all the things that they experienced and saw with Jesus. And so it's kind of like we are hearing the directions to this picture. You may not have seen this picture with your eyes. Only I was the only one that could see this picture, but I did my best to describe to you what this picture looked like, and you tried to imagine what it looked like and tried to imitate, right? And so in the same way as the Bible is written by people that experienced and saw Jesus, what we do is we read the Bible and try to imagine and try to hear what is being explained and described as best as we can. And we could even picture what the Bible is saying and what these stories are. And through the Bible, we can know what Jesus is like and all that he has done for us. Jesus has made a promise to return one day. And we know that our life here on earth is not all there is. Jesus gives us hope for eternity. And so even though we may go through, you know, good times and hard times here on earth, we know that the important thing is that there is an eternity, and we always have hope in eternity, and that one day we will be with him. We will live with him forever. When Thomas saw Jesus and believed, Jesus said to him in John 20:29, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." That's us. We haven't seen Jesus with our eyes, but we still believe that he is alive. Jesus says we are blessed when we believe in him. Today is Thanksgiving Sunday, and there are many things that we can be thankful for. You know, if I were to ask you what you are thankful for, you may think of a lot of things that you see with your eyes. Food, toys, clothes, house, family, and you know, these are all good things to be thankful for. Or maybe on the other hand, you may have a hard time being thankful because some of the bad things that we see around us going on, right? But the Bible says to be thankful in all circumstances. And just like God wants us to believe and trust in Jesus, even though we may not see him with our eyes, this Thanksgiving, I want to challenge you. Can we try to be thankful no matter how good or how bad things may look to us in our eyes? Can we trust that God is in control, and then the life he gives us when we know Jesus is enough for us to be thankful? Once we can have that kind of thankfulness, once we can begin there, then we can be thankful for all the blessings, all the good things that God has given us. But we can still be thankful when we don't have all these things, when all these things are taken away or they're no longer there. So let's begin with that challenge this Thanksgiving. You know, if you picked up the craft kit, you guys may have some of these, you know, colorful leaves that was included for our craft today, which is a Thanksgiving wreath. So I want you guys to begin right now, you know, take some time to write down things that you are thankful for. Before you make the wreath, I want you guys to write it down on these pieces of, you know, leaves or shapes that you got, so that as you hang it up, you can see the things and be reminded of the things that you are thankful for. But even if you didn't get this, even if you don't have this, I want you guys to write it down on a piece of paper, at least 5 things that you are thankful for this year or this, you know, this day. And I want you guys to put it up in your room or around the house somewhere so that you can be reminded and you can thank God for all those things. So I want you guys to write down the things that you are thankful for right now, okay? All right, let's come to the Lord in prayer. Father God, Lord, we are just so thankful for all the blessings, all the things that you have given us. But more than that, we are thankful for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for us, Lord. And that through your resurrection, we know that we can have new life in you, Lord. And so this Thanksgiving, may our hope, may our gratitude lie first on who you are and who we are in you, Lord God, and that after that we can begin to remember and think about all the things that you so greatly blessed us with. We thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, now it's time for offerings. So let's bring our offerings, put in your offering box, and let's sing this offering song as our worship to God. Let's sing together. Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.